Does President Obama need a so-called black agenda? The topic started when TV talk show host Tavis-Smiley criticized the Reverend Al Sharpton for saying the president didn't need to have a black agenda. Sharpton let him have it when Smiley called into the Sharpton radio show.
I don't think the president needs to ballyhoo a black agenda. That does not mean the president does not need to deal with a black agenda. The president does not need to get out there and do what we should be doing. Saying the president shouldn't ballyhoo a black agenda is not saying the president should not be held to a black agenda or deal with a black agenda. And that is not what you said. Don't talk to us like we stupid, Tavis.
Smiley, who is host of Tavis Smiley on PBS, planned a discussion in Chicago on March 20th entitled, We Count, The Black Agenda is the American Agenda. He says he has invited the Reverend Al Sharpton, who joins me now along with Dr. Boyce Watkins, finance professor at Syracuse University and a contributor to thegrio.com. Gentlemen, good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Now, Reverend, I understand you have yet to get that invitation. That true?
Yeah, well, what I said when I heard it, the first time I heard it was on radio that I was announced I was going to be there, that I had no knowledge of it. But, you know, that notwithstanding that, there are many conferences. Dr. Ron Daniels has a Black Agenda conference I think is great. The conferences are not the problem or the point to me. The point is, let's solve the problems. Mm. Black unemployment is double that of many of whites in this country. We are the ones that really need a health bill because we pay more and get less quality health care. So when the president of the NAACP, Ben Jealous, and the president of Urban League, National Urban League, Mark Murray Allen, I met with the president, we met on these issues. And he said, I'm the president of the United States. I deal with the labor agenda. I deal with the business agenda. Here's what I'm doing. And he laid out, I spent $85 million last year on health centers in our communities and in the black communities. And I'm trying to, in urban communities that affect blacks, I'm trying to do more. He signed just last Friday and said he was going to do it. A $95 million in his executive orders, it went to $95 million to historic black colleges with $850 million over the next 9 years. This is more than we've ever had for historic black colleges.
Right.
He's talking about doing things in terms of the green jobs, training programs, $85 million. So the question is, do we want to argue about naming it or do we want to solve the problems of blacks as well as others since he's the president of all? And I think that that's what he ran on. I know Mr. Smiley didn't support him, was very critical of him then, critical of him now. The campaign is over. We need to get the change we voted for, and I see the president moving in that direction. As long as he is, I think we ought to support him and solve the problem and not get involved in who's going to attend what productions.
Well, to that end, though, sir, doctor, do you think there is dissension among the leaders in this community? Because among the things you wrote, our black leadership boat is in uncharted waters, and every leader has an oar pointed in their own direction. So does that mean you can't have a cohesive focus?
No, it doesn't mean you can't have a cohesive focus, but what it does mean is that to think that every black leader is going to be on the same page, it's like saying every white leader is going to be on the same page. We know that's not true. I think that both Reverend Sharpton and Tavis Smiley are men who have sacrificed quite a bit for the black community, and they both deserve their respect. At the same time, I think that when you talk about a black agenda, I am in agreement with Reverend Sharpton on this, that just because you have a black agenda does not mean that you have to demand that the president name it the black agenda. I think that when you also talk about President Obama, whom I've been supportive of as well as critical of, depending on the situation, you have to really make sure that your critiques are objective. And I think that with Tavis spending 3 years chasing down the president, unlike anything I've ever seen before, I don't think that he can say that he's an objective evaluator of the Obama administration. So at the end of the day, when you talk about the black agenda, there are three key areas that we have to focus on: education, economics, mass incarceration, and the criminal justice system. We don't understand they're all connected. When you don't educate these kids and you put them out here without jobs, then effectively they're more likely to go to prison. That is undermining the integrity of the black family. Women don't have men to marry because all the men are locked away in prison. And the United States has to deal with that. And I think President Obama understands that, or at least I hope he does. At the very least, our community must hold him accountable to ensure that our issues are always on the table.
You're absolutely setting up an interview I'm going to do in this next block when we talk to education leaders about exactly this problem, particularly within the black community. But I want to get to something that you said and have you talk about this in response, Reverend. And that would be in the column that Dr. Watkins wrote, he writes, "The rift between Sharpton and Smiley is an introduction to the post-Obama America where being black no longer means being on the same page. It means that the man, Smiley, who once referred to Bill Clinton as the first black president, cannot look a real black president in the eye and give him the benefit of the doubt. It means that Al Sharpton and other civil rights leaders are forced to do the dirty work on racial equality because our black president has been terrorized into political silence on issues of race." Your response to that, Reverend?
My response is that black leaders have always had different approaches. Dr. King and Roy Wilkins and Whitney Young in the 60s had one approach, Malcolm X another. That is nothing new, and that will always be, and that's probably healthy. I think that the problem is that we've got to deal with the results. Today, President Obama's announcing with former Secretary of State Colin Powell and his wife a $3.5 billion budget to deal with failing schools because of the rate of dropout rate that Dr. Boyce Watkins talked about, education, some of the national action that we're going to have been committed to. Now, am I going to say to the president in a meeting that he made very public in the Oval Office, I don't care about a dropout rate of black kids and that you're giving us billions of dollars. I don't care about health care and that you're putting millions there. I don't care you're giving more than historic black college. I want you to put your fists up and say black power. Then I'm really more interested in symbolism than I am the substantive problems of our community. I lead an organization, a national organization. I'm not a commentator. And I understand commentators like Mr. Smiley, who've been critical of the president, have to do their job. Our job is to deliver something tangible. Our people are in very, very serious conditions. They need a president that includes them in the change and not just gives them some rhetorical good feeling without some results.
All right. And then, Dr. Watkins, what is the first point would you suggest to the president, the first area to tackle? This is a president who has so much on his plate, and all those issues that you chronicled as being pervasively challenging the black community. Where's the first place to start?
You got to start with jobs. Right now, we talk about the American unemployment rate at about 9.7%. The black unemployment rate is 17.3%. Mm. The black male unemployment rate is 19.5%.
But does some of that stem from lack of education, the high school dropout rate, people that aren't getting the education to get those jobs? So don't you even need to take a step backwards and get back to the beginning in education?
You've got to take a lot of steps in a lot of different directions. And I think that right now, if you're talking about what the president needs to address right now to protect his presidency, he has to address jobs. And I've been saying that for about the last 6 months now while we spent all of our time talking about health care. And then once you've stabilized the economy, you've got to attack the education system. When you've got black boys being 4 to 5 times more likely to be placed in special education than the white kids, and you've got all these kids that aren't graduating, these kids going to schools that don't have the same resources as the schools in the suburbs, that's a problem. That is Jim Crow in the flesh. Mm. Now, if you want to take the next step, Mr. Eric Holder, you've got to realize that we've got modern-day slavery in the prison system. The United States incarcerate more of its citizens than any other country in the world. Most of those citizens are African Americans. That leads to the deterioration of the black family because all these kids are growing up without their fathers. When you marginalize these men once they've been released from prison, you're further adding to the marginalization. So education, economics, and incarceration all tie together, and I hope the president will address that.
That's what I'm saying. You ask for one thing to focus on, and the fact is it is all tied together. No, I mean, there's nothing wrong with your answer. It's all good. Dr. Boyce Watkins and Reverend Al Sharpton, gentlemen, thank you for the discussion.
Thank you.